started. Sorry we're a little late. It is January 25th, 2016. And we have just called to order, so I will take a motion to accept the minutes from December. Sorry I missed the meeting.
So moved.
Seconded.
Any changes, corrections, additions?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Adjustments to the agenda. We need to give our annual support to Harts Brook, so if you can help me remember to do that. When do you want to do that? Under
right now.
Now? Right now? Let's do it right now so we don't forget.
So annually.
We have to recognize all the private schools in town.
So annually, because I don't believe, Mr. Pfeiffer, you were here last year for this, Harts Brook School that operates in Hadley, it's required by law that the public school district approve its existence, its plan every year.
Yeah.
And so what I can tell you is that they sent over all the documents they sent to me last year that they've sent in previous years. So I reviewed their enrollment, their financials, they have an unqualified audit for FY15, they have all of their building inspection certificates in place. And they also sent over, they had no substantial revisions to their curriculum. So it's required of the school committee in the district in which an independent school like that operates, that you approve their operations.
Hmm. Questions or concerns?
What if we don't approve? I'm just curious what weight we have.
We'd probably see them.
Sued.
I'm sure they would seek an appeal. I don't think that they've shut their door tomorrow. I'm sure that they would seek an appeal, ask us to delineate the grounds for refusing to approve them, it would have to be because they were fiscally not viable. They didn't have, we thought their curriculum was inappropriate or not viable. They had insufficient enrollment to support their financial plan. We would have to give a reason,
okay.
And then they'd have an opportunity to appeal that, which is why they send me their packet. I asked for their packet last year. They send it every year. It includes their nurse's report, their building inspection certificates, the reports that they filed with the Department of Ed, their calendar schedules, the faculty CVs on their faculty, and all of their financials.
Can I see them?
Of course you can. And I do apologize. What happened, and Harts Brook apologizes, last week on Thursday, Harts Brook called our office and said that their deadline for approval is Wednesday. And I explained to them, which is why it still wasn't on your packet, that if I hadn't received, if I had not received their documents, that it couldn't go in the school committee packet. And we received their documents in the mail today.
So you reviewed it? Per the criteria, and if it meets, yeah.
So will these documents become part of the public record
for
the meeting?
Okay. Yep.
Hi, girls.
Hello.
Welcome.
I'll make a motion to approve continuation of the operation of the Harts Brook School.
I'll second that.
Need more time?
No.
All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Moving on to presentations. I really don't like when we have a PowerPoint because I can't
see what it's.
So, Helping Harts, how are you?
Hello. Hey. Nice to see you.
Oh, okay.
You too. I won't make you happy. And you are school committee.
Hi.
So, we are here from Helping Harts. I have Heidi Beckwith, Steph Berry, and Corey Feldovic, and Heather Clash is also on the board as well. We are here to give you a big fat check. So
all
we
right.
have a really big fat check for $15,000.
Wow.
So that's last year's race. And just a couple quick things. The race this year is slated for April 10th. So we're hoping that we get your support again. And we are opening registration tomorrow, so if anybody would love to have one of these fabulous Helping Harts long sleeve Under Armour shirts, I suggest do it quickly because it goes to the first 100 registrants. And we also are offering women's sizing this year too, so it's an added bonus. I need to do a personal shout out. Thank you to my board members. So I'm going to rename their names. Try not to cry. Shelly Bermucci, Corey Feltovic, Steph Berry, Heidi Beckwith, Roxanne Downey, Sarah Pomazano, Heather Klesch, Haley Jolly, and Kelly Higgins. They are all enormous part of this. And without their help, and their continued support, it would not happen. So thank you.
Thank you.
And thank you when you're out there. So that being said, I hope you guys, you know, continue to support, and the teachers are feeling the effects of this money that we're giving. And you know, I get thank you notes from teachers every so often in the mailbox saying, you know, hey, thank you for the item that, you know, we got. And you know, I love to hear back, so I continue to give, and hopefully you guys will continue to receive. So but thank you.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
You're welcome. So I'm gonna present this check.
Can we just
present this check as well?
I can. So Paul just asked, how is the money used? I can pull up my fancy dancy spreadsheet. I can also speak in general terms. And Stacey, you might be able to also help me in some principles with some of our purchases.
Yeah.
What we started doing this year is there's actually a spreadsheet that Stacey and her board can see. So it's every request, when it's funded, when it's delivered. And Mike can help with this too, and some of the things that we've purchased. So we've purchased actual computer devices, right? We've used some of this money for Chromebooks, for iPads, for, I thought I saw Paula in the room.
Yeah.
Paula was very excited to get, I can't
Osmo.
Remember the name of it.
Osmo. Osmo, yeah.
That's right. Osmo. There was some robotics type activities that went down toward K-bots into kindergarten. There's also supplies, because the teachers can advocate for whatever they think that they need to do their jobs more effectively. It doesn't just have to be computers. So we have art supplies and music supplies. I know Mrs. Brain was very, very pleased with the generosity of Helping Hearts.
And this is it's a fund that the teachers can ask for equipment?
The teachers make a request. Helping Hearts gives us an idea of what the funding is. The teachers make their requests. Then both principals, and I and Pat sit down with Stacy. We review all of the requests. We populate them into this spreadsheet, and we explain the rationale for the things that we would recommend. Sometimes we say that we can either we might be able to fund something out of the operating budget, or there might be another funding source at Hopkins, like the Board of Trustees. So it's 100% the teachers, and at the end of the day, Helping Hearts, it's their money that they give to us, but they really make a decision about, they approve our recommendations on how we'd like to spend it.
$1,000 in library books.
Thank you.
What else did we have?
Contributions to the music, physical education, and art programs.
Yeah,
OT.
To get the equipment for our occupational therapists, our physical therapists.
Yeah. So it's making a difference.
It's great.
It's awesome. And I just hope we continue to get, you know, the support of the teachers and the families and the businesses, because that's, you know,
that's
how we do it. So.
Hey, Stacey, what was the enrollment this year compared to last?
We're actually right at the same amount. We're about 600 for registrants.
Yeah.
And then if you added another 200 or 300 for people that are just there for the block party afterwards or volunteers. But what we did see was a growth in our runners, which is good, because if the race is growing in participants, then that's what we really want, because the race is growing, it's just going to go forward. So so we're hoping, we changed our registration format this year to hopefully ease the pain of signing up an entire family. You don't have to do it one by one and go back in and do it. We have it so that you can register your whole family at once and just do it once. So the feature that caused us not to get our registration open this weekend, but it's going to be
Thanks, Stacey.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
I'll shake your hand.
That's right. So just to underscore Linda's comments, our faculty are, thank you, Stacey, our faculty are very, very appreciative. I'm appreciative. I see how much it means to them. I see how happy it makes them. They're just downright giddy. It's like Christmas for them. So,
it
is. They're very excited. And you and your board certainly don't need to do this. So your generosity, it just means so much. Thank you.
Thanks.
Yeah.
So that was presentation A. You guys are presentation H. So before we go to presentation B, will you introduce yourselves so that everyone on camera knows that we have new student reps to the school committee?
Sure. I'm Jenny Moss, and I'm a senior.
And I'm Bridget Lasher, and I'm also a senior.
Welcome. It's super fun and exciting meetings. Right, people?
Right.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Look at Mr. Beck. It's so true. Okay. I believe Ms. Camuso, you're filling in for Mr. Burns on the support for moratorium?
Yes.
You're up.
Okay. So I believe that you got the letter and the write-up as well. So the union is looking for your support for the moratorium, which is a hiatus on using the test scores for 3 years, so it's not that there wouldn't be any testing. And the union feels very strongly that the time would be used well to do some research and see how they're used so that the best decisions could be made for our students. So we're kind of all here for any other specific questions that you guys have about that.
Well, I will start. I actually thought the angle you were going to go with was that we would ask for a hiatus simply because Massachusetts is kind of in chaos right now in terms of what is the test, what is the format of the test, how is the test going to be implemented, paper copy or electronically. Mm-hmm. And I don't really see that in the MOA, but from what you just said, it's not using the results, so maybe that's kind of where you're headed.
Yeah, I think part of that is just because of when the Act was first created, and so events have changed since then, and so now there is this new potential issue and complication around testing and the way that it's going to look and the changes that are made. So that's, of course, an added component. It's just not one that was originally with the MTA's thoughts. So that, of course, is also a concern as well, and some, you know, school districts are still doing PARC. And what elements are going to be added to our MCAS tests that are from PARC is also a bit of a who knows that we'll find out this year, or the kids will find out. So that, of course, also brings some complications. And again, the testing still occurs. We just wouldn't use that data for student graduation, teacher evaluations, and all of those pieces, and the district.
I don't think that's really clear from the letter that you gave us. As the MOA?
Yeah.
I didn't catch that either, actually.
No, the letter, do you mean the second one that Mr. Burns gave you?
The whereas is.
Yeah. In that language.
Yeah.
Okay. Do you have any thoughts on that, Jack?
So I don't disagree with what you're saying. I don't know that the school committee should, I don't know if, you know, the school committee sign on to stuff from the MTA usually. But certainly what you're saying and what you presented us, they don't
Yeah, so some of the information that I'm saying is just directly from the Act, which is several pages longer. So
yeah.
I think what Mr. Burns sent was modeled after some language that some other towns had used. Mm-hmm. So perhaps maybe that just wasn't, you know, as specific as you guys would like to see. Because the Act itself obviously has a lot more specifics. It itemizes, you know, the task force that's created and all the different people and where they come from and how they get elected and what they do and the timeline. So it's all much more specific. So what I'm getting from you is that you would like to know more about those specifics to consider before considering anything else.
Yeah, I think if you want us to sign on, you need to send us the whole
thing. Okay. I can give him that information. Are there any other questions or things that you want us to look into in response to that?
May I suggest something? I'm not certain, although perhaps, yeah, if you're saying the Act, maybe this is the case. I would wonder if the school committee would have the authority to say that testing would not be used for graduation, because I don't know, maybe you all do, if graduation requirements are set entirely locally, or if state regulation and law would dictate that.
The MCAS overrode that.
So people tried
to say it wasn't, and the state said, no, you can't do that.
And the state said you have to use it. So that's just one place where I would be careful about that, is that it would be it would not behoove the school committee to vote on something that is counter to law that could unintentionally punish a student.
I think we're just looking more for the support, not looking for you to decide that it won't be used at graduation, because as you're saying, that can't happen. But just the support behind the general act and the ideas, if it goes further, just to say that you're in agreement with those thoughts, not necessarily to say there would be any changes made to anything that's happening. But I also still understand that you want to know what thoughts you would potentially be agreeing with. So I can take that back to Mr. Burns and we can sort of dig in further and prepare that for you.
Thank you.
Okay. Yep.
Other thoughts or questions? Otherwise, we'll see you next month. Is that good?
That was good, thank you.
Okay. Ms. Camuzzo.
Me again?
Yes, please.
Okay. So the second piece, Dr. McKenzie, did they get?
Yes.
Okay, good. I wasn't sure. So, as you know, we talked before, and you approved the trip to Italy and Germany in 2017 in February. Since then, I've had some difficulty with enrollment, and so I've done some digging around and spoke to several different parents and students. One of the problems is that, of course, whenever you go, you miss games of some sort, but during the February break, it's during tournament. So people who would like to go that are basketball players cannot go or will be much less willing to go during a tournament versus a couple regular season games. And I've spoken to the parents and the students of those enrolled already, and they're all fine with the change being made to April. So I'm just hoping that you guys are also as well, because I feel like that will boost the enrollment for the trip. And there is a slight increase in cost. One of the things that I did talk to the parents about that I told them was that there is an extension in the trip, so that's something that could always be taken off as well. If cost becomes prohibitive, then that would reduce that cost and bring it back down. And the company does always run different discounts, so right now if they enroll by the end of February, it's $100 off, so that max price of $3,200 also ends up being a little bit lower.
Any questions or concerns on that? I don't have a concern about switching the date, but I mentioned to Linda earlier that the MASC listserv has had discussions about school sponsoring third-party overseas trips and suggesting that schools might want to reconsider and have policies that don't have us specifically endorsing it, but have policies for how a teacher can advertise in the school.
Mm-hmm.
Because my understanding of why we do that is to allow you to advertise it to students.
In the school. Right.
So I think maybe the policy subcommittee could look into whether it still makes sense for us to be endorsing or just to have a policy that allows you to
I'm opposed simply because I don't want to address the field trip policy again, but
well,
fine.
The whole thing.
Okay.
Third party.
So remind me, did we endorse the trip or did we? We did.
We approved.
We approved the trip, but we don't have any. You know, we can't really take responsibility for something that we have no control over.
Yeah.
And there's, I think it's kind of gray. It gets to be kind of gray.
So if I'm clear, you're looking for the policy subcommittee to come together, look specifically at the language that has a school committee approving field trips, and perhaps with policy subcommittee and legal counsel having language that acknowledges that we support opportunities for students or whatever the school committee wants to say, and then perhaps some legal language that is specific around this is not, these are third party run trips over which we have limited oversight.
Exactly.
Okay.
But in the meantime,
I can send you this stuff from
then. Since that will take one sec, since that will take several meetings to get through that. It would be good if we could make this change now, unless you have a comment first.
It has nothing to do with what's going on.
A little brief one. Obviously, I have children that play both sports, basketball and softball. Is there a way that we could consider, and I don't know if it would be decided tonight or not, but I don't think it's really fair to be like, we're choosing one sport over the other sport per se, but is there a way to more say, during April vacation, that maybe we would make a conscious effort not to have any games scheduled during the softball season, being that it's regular season, and maybe that means, maybe that means something like, instead of two games a week on the off, on the other weeks, in the month of April, that we had three or something, just to try to you know, make it a little more equitable for all students, whether they play either sport.
We did do that.
So I talked to Mr. Sudnick right away, and that's why this became an issue for February, because he does try and move the games as he can, but because it's tournament when it would be happening,
it's not
February break is so much.
It's February. It's
later that month, year.
Okay.
So he's already looked into it, and so that's where the timeline falls, and so that he can't really change. But he does always make his best effort to accommodate and reduce the number of games that students would be missing, or consequences, because it is a school field trip, so there shouldn't be consequences.
So if we have the school committee endorse, like, there not being any games during that week, obviously we could set up a schedule to reflect that. Am I right?
I think we have more control over April vacation games and more athletic directors on board with similar issues at their own schools. So there's dual interest from school to school. Sorry, dual interest. Whereas in February, the final games of the regular season in winter sports are the schedules are often backed up against the tournament qualification deadlines.
Right.
And so there's almost never flexibility in February, and so very often there can be no games or one game if necessary scheduled in April because we're not as backed up. It's earlier in the season, so.
Right. And so I don't think that is. I don't think this committee will vote on that. That's kind of grabbing more power than we actually have.
Just like
but
more
we will make the request.
Kind of
so. But a motion to move from February to April?
Yeah, motion to move the support the move from February to April.
Second. Either one of those guys seconded
exactly.
that.
All got it.
All in favor?
Aye.
All right. Thank you. It's Mr. Duffy. School Brain Student Information Management System.
And while he's putting this together, I will say to you, because you're probably wondering, why in the world would we be listening to something on a student information management system? Because a transition is not in the FY16 operating budget, and the only way, if we were to change information management systems, that we could conceivably do that and be ready July 1 would be to pay out of school choice. So it becomes your issue if we pay out of school choice funds. So and this is just, sorry, Ruby.
Why do we need to change our system?
So we were gonna just give four quick slides of why we're looking at a more integrated student information management system of moving from Redeker, a system that would allow us to integrate, he'll go through it, the pieces, and why, and the cost avoidance in future years.
Okay.
At the end of the day, that's why you're hearing about that. Normally, to the point of things being operational, this is normally not a school committee decision. What you're listening for is I compelled to spend school choice money, which only the school committee can decide to do?
Okay.
Yeah, I think everybody knows me, but we haven't met. I'm Mike Guffey, I'm the tech director for the district. So we're considering moving to School Brains, which is a Massachusetts-based company, Sandwich, Massachusetts, and we would replace Administrators Plus, which is from Redeker Software in Hamden, Massachusetts. Just a little background. We've actually been on Redeker for a very long time, since the middle 80s.
Wow.
But for many reasons, as you see here, it might be time for a change. Massachusetts Department of Ed has endorsed School Brains as their recommended SIS vendor.
And SIS is a student information system.
Yeah. And School Brains is much more integrated than current set of applications we have. We have, as you'll see in another slide, there's several applications. We have a separate one for special education, one for grading, another one for a fee for the parent portal. All of these will be integrated with School Brains. One set of software, one database. We wouldn't have updates that we have to be sure to get done through these other systems. And one of the biggest reasons is that the state reporting that we have to do is extremely problematic, and School Brains seems to have fewer problems than most of the student information system vendors. They're not problem-free, but they seem to have fewer problems. And reasons for that seems to be on both sides, both the SIS vendors and the State Department of Ed. We're hoping with school brands, the amount of hours that we're spending on this now is very, very large, so we're hoping that will be reduced. Right now, the licensing with Admin Plus is by the user, so that as you add users, the cost goes up. So we don't put it out there that widely. So with School Brains, it's basically you pay by the student. It doesn't matter how many users you have. So it would allow us to give teachers access based on need to know for the data. And that way, we'd have everybody working off the same set of data, the same database, and all the users will be seeing the same information rather than going in between a specific one for whatever position you hold. I've already made my point about the last data, right? Apparently, we have various suppliers, so I'm going to switch to that. And the cost savings will go to that. So this is cost savings comparison to what we have now. As you see, School Brains is based on the cost of $9 a student. And one interesting thing that they do is that because it's endorsed by Department of Ed, they're counting all the schools that use School Brains as a cumulative student count. And the more students you have, the lower the price per student. So this is considerably reduced if we were just buying it outright. Because there's many, many schools, I don't know how many there are, but there's many, many schools using School Brains in Massachusetts. So that cumulative total brings down the cost per student. The one module that's excluded is the communications module, which is the calling system that we use for email and calling. But that's still worthwhile, again, because you have one database, one set of addresses, one set of email addresses, one set of phone numbers. So that would be a big advantage. There is a one-time implementation fee that would be paid this fiscal year. And so that would be the upfront cost for it. The licensing fee would start as of July. Yeah.
Is the $15,000 cost a data conversion cost, or is it for the software? Do we have a data conversion cost on top of that?
No.
Okay.
No. So that's training and data conversion, primarily that, training and data conversion.
Mike, is the communications module that you mentioned, is that going to, can that replace the one call system?
Yeah, that's it. Yes, right. That's
the
intent.
I'm sorry, I don't know what the price of the one call system
is. It's actually on the bottom of this.
Okay.
The actual cost is less for one call. So it's like $400 less
right.
for one call. But the big advantage is, again, we don't have to do any updating. And it's always risky to have an emergency and somebody's phone number has changed or email address has changed and we haven't applied the updates. So currently we're paying for all these modules within Redeker for a total cost of $9,400. And we have for grading, we have pay this company Blackboard for Hopkins grading. We pay for an elementary school for the grading. The parent portal we pay for. SEMS Tracker is a SPED application. SNAP nursing software, which we're probably going to keep. Virtual Town to Schools is the webpage that you get into. And then the one call. So all of these added up. Comes up to $22,000. And the annual potential savings here, if you were to replace all of them, would be $15,000. But we're definitely going to keep SNAP because the nursing staff did some surveys at schools that are using school grades, and they weren't happy with it. But SNAP is a very specialized application, really has a lot of knowledge about the nursing profession, and we agree that they would stay on that. And also, Birch and Townsend Schools, I'm not 100% positive that we'll be able to replace our town, our school webpage with School Brain, so I put that in there as a potential option of keeping that. So overall, looking at a worst case scenario, we're looking at a $9,400 per year savings, plus all the advantages of having a truly integrated system.
Which is where you have your 1.6 years, and the most conservative estimate,
years of payback, that's based on the implementation fee.
Are there additional fees, like 2 years from now when they're upgrading it? I mean, do they talk about, you know, you have to pay for that too, or?
All the modules that they offer are $9 per student. Everything that they offer. Is that your question?
Well, are there additional costs? One thing they have told us, Heather, is that the minimum it can get to, I think, is 7 or 5 per pupil, if more schools in the Commonwealth, because it's a statewide contract.
Yeah.
But they, to my knowledge, they did not indicate that we would anticipate additional licensing costs in the future for upgrades.
No, they don't.
So you can ask them very specifically that question.
I consider it fairly small, because the numbers are getting so large where you have the different price rates. It's possible that the $9 per student would go down.
Right.
If enough schools get on it.
So aside from the one-time implementation fee, if you don't mind scrolling back up to the top, all we should expect to see as far as costs are the two lines, the per student $9 and the $270 for the communication tool?
Correct.
Yes. Two services.
So they would anticipate seeing that the only cost we would see annually going forward should be the $7,254.
Yes.
Yes.
And your hope is to purchase this year in FY16 so that it's implemented for July 1, FY17?
Right.
And it would be ready for the school year in September?
Yes.
So you want $15,000 in school choice?
That's what he wants. Chris?
So I say give it to him.
Come on, Chris. That was a little too easy.
Save money.
We don't have to do typical procurement for this because it's on the state bid list.
That's right.
So in summary, said it, much more integrated solution, one set of data. All the teachers and staff would have access to it. You know, they can look up student information.
I can offer it because I live in this database to help my gov here. Right now, if a staff member would like a contact number for a parent or guardian of one of the students, they need to come to me to get it. They can't go into their desktop and pull up student information. They have to come through me. One call. I work with Mike and manually update that via an import system. So if somebody changes a phone number, I have to actually go in and change it manually in the system. This way, we make it in one place. It updates special ed. It updates the communication system. It's instantaneous. It's not multiple databases, which is what we're working in right now. And you know, you trust the system is importing and syncing and doing that sort of thing. It takes a lot of personnel to kind of evaluate the data, understand the data. We have 52 data elements per student. It's a two-digit code. And, you know, to make sure all of that information is correct and mapped correctly, it has a financial impact, so.
It has a financial impact, and when we, fortunately, the state agreed to give us an appeal because our data elements were off on our ELL designations, which almost put us into level 3 this year.
Yeah.
And not because everybody wasn't working really hard, but it's, as Corey said, 52 data, two-digit data elements for every single student in the district.
I mean, they've informed us that one of the things that they'll do because of their collaboration with the state is they would create the field. Like this year, we had DOE 30 implemented, which is a Title I code, particularly of interest at the elementary school, and they will add it in there rather than every single time you're entering a student having to go pull up the database handbook and going through it, making sure it hadn't been updated. That's one of the things. Of course, we'll still do that so we understand what the codes are and correctly input them.
But that's one of the features of the program, is that it will really support the folks on the front lines that are keying that information and have them do it in an accurate fashion.
Sounds good. Any questions?
Corey, one more question. I always think about the start of paperwork at the beginning of the year and the...
Yes, so this will be very exciting for you, because I know everyone loves getting the back-to-school paperwork. I don't want to commit anything off the bat, because we, again, would need to set up the school year 16-17 and have the frontline staff and everybody else involved understand how it operates before it would be kind of unleashed to the parents and guardians. But that is one of the features, is that it would have a holding bin that parents could go on and update information, and it would cue members of the administrative tasks to go in and staff to go in and review the information and accept it. Right now we do a verification page, which is an improvement on what we had previously, let you know what we have. But we also have to go back in and manually key all that information, and it takes a very long time.
Yeah.
And so this way, the hope is most definitely to do that. But it would also update it, and then all the people on the staff that would need access to that information would have access to it. It's got some really nice features. I'm sure it won't be without its challenges converting, but I think we were really impressed with what we were shown.
Great. Thank you, Mike.
And one thing we clearly didn't have time to do in terms of analysis was, thank you, I appreciate Mike for the presentation and the analysis, the cost avoidance analysis, but what you heard from Corey, thank you very much for that, Corey, that was a very eloquent non-point, is the increase in productivity. We couldn't analyze without making people do time studies that they don't have time to do now because they're entering data elements.
But next year.
That's right.
Time studies, all for all of you.
To show how efficient we're being. Yeah, that's right.
But we will get increased productivity.
And accuracy. That's really accuracy.
Yeah. Are we ready on this, or would you like more time to consider?
Nope. That's good.
I'll make a motion to approve using $15,000 from school choice funds for the one-time implementation fee for the School Brain Student Information Management System.
Nicely done.
Thanks. Second.
Okay, all in favor?
Aye.
Done. In favor too. You got it.
Great, thank you.
So maybe skip to the students, and perhaps Mike can help me put this up. I need what you just put away.
Oh, okay.
Is that okay?
Sure. Okay with you guys to go to go early?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, we're good. So we have a summary of what I just to present.
Okay.
Okay. We have a summary of four items to present. I'll be addressing the first two. Bridget will address the second two. So on Friday, January 22nd, all the classes had a meeting to discuss Spirit Week activities and competitions. And Spirit Week is going to be held on February 8th through 12th, which is a week before February vacation. And since we implemented the new schedule this year, there's going to be a survey distributed to students and faculty to gather information about how this new schedule is working. And they'll be administered electronically since the midterms are over, so the information can be gathered and assessed prior to the registration for the upcoming year.
My turn?
Yeah.
Okay. So between the sports seasons, the Hopkins students are going to be hosting a community event, and it's kind of designed just to get the family feedback so that the school can use it. And the Hopkins staff is basically just using their views for its like core values and the student learning experiences. Expectations, the student learning expectations, and there was a select of students called the TAB Trainers, and they were trained by the North Quabbin Meditation, and they're going to design this event with Mr. Beck and invite families from both the schools to engage with the students and dialogue to basically frame the future path for our school. And then for the fourth point is you recently changed the policy about cap and gowns, and the senior class was also informed of it as well. Mr. Beck had a discussion with the members of the senior class, and we were basically updated and informed of what was going on. And the whole class was then able to understand why the color of cap and gowns were changed to the one color that you guys voted on.
just to be in compliance with the law. And then on the Friday's class meeting, we basically had a non-binding survey that was taken to basically, in a way, we kind of want to see if maybe we could get your approval to change it so that the students that are graduating can possibly pick the color of their cap and gowns. And then we just kind of wanted to bring it up to you guys in this meeting.
What were the survey results?
The survey results were, was we had a couple options between picking one color that the whole class would wear, and they would vote on that color. And then another option was is possibly having the students be able to pick the color that they'd want to wear. And then another option was as that they had no preference, or another option was to put other ideas or things that you could possibly like think of, like other suggestions for the color of cap and gowns.
And so we gathered the suggestions and ideas that came up at the request of student council. Mm-hmm. Just to get a sense of, since this is the graduating class that's going through the transition under this new policy, there, as I had mentioned in a prior school committee meeting, that the students wanted to make sure that they were able to at least have their voices in one way or another be heard. And so the recommendation of school council was to conduct a survey. So Jenny and Bridget, and obviously have that survey just be for the purpose of gathering opinion, reviewed the survey beforehand as members of this group and made a couple modifications to it based on ideas and things that they had heard at other schools as well. And we just distributed and divided it out really into two groups. The largest number of students, 27 students, still wanted to be able to wear two colors as their preference. And then the other group of students, those that either had no preference or in one way or another voted for one color, were 21 students. So the class was roughly split down the middle. And then I think there was one student in the comment, and it was good for us to, we handled it with a sense of humor. Because coming out of the initial discussion, we were very pleased with the quality of the discussion overall was very civil and respectful, and you know, people used really appropriate language in ways that we didn't necessarily expect, because some folks were really well trained for that discussion, and others were not, but kids were great. What we found was, and we felt like everybody really understood the thinking behind the new policy. And we did have one comment that came out that said, which was a clear indication that at least one member of the senior class really didn't get it yet, because it said, boys wear white, girls wear, boys wear blue, girls wear white. So it was pretty clear that at least one kid didn't necessarily understand that conversation. But outside of that, it was roughly 50-50 in terms of what their preferences would be. You know, and I did let them, I did make them aware prior to putting out the survey that this is where the school committee stands now, and if this is something that's going to be brought forward, it's going to need to be brought forward by students. And so, yeah, is there anything else that either of you guys want to add to that?
Not right now.
No, that seemed to cover it.
I'm sorry, just to be clear, were you making a specific recommendation, or was it more to inform us of, that sounds like a good dialogue?
We kind of like informed it, but then in a way we also, I mean, I know as of like my side with a couple of students that in a way I'm like representing, we didn't know if there was a possibility that in a way you guys could rethink your decision and possibly let us choose the color that we wanted for graduation.
Choose one color, or each person choose whatever color they
like,
want?
Like, we could possibly decide on two colors or three colors, because Mr. Beck and I talked earlier about how one school had them, the senior graduating class, decide between three colors on which three colors they wanted to wear the day of their graduation.
Mm-hmm. Well, I think we always intended that the senior class or the administration, whoever has been doing this for years, because the students have never had any say in this, we picked the color they wanted. I don't think the school committee had any preference. But I think we were pretty much unanimous in our opinion that it should be a single color to reflect the changes in the law and the changes, the social changes that have happened pretty rapidly, really, for a lot of people. But I guess my thought is that, you know, if you come to us and you say, oh, you know, this, let it be the last year. Then next year we have some kids and they come, oh, but you let me do it last year. And you know, sometimes you just have to bite the bullet and be the first ones.
So Bridget, I see you're trying to maybe with provide a third alternative. Is that correct? Where you're sort of saying it's not the traditional blue and white, it's not a single color, but each person can choose, and maybe you give it just a limited number of options. You mentioned up to three. And in doing so that way, I guess I'm curious what the dialogue was around that. So you heard sort of the intent of trying to, I mean, it's in part to meet the law, but I think more so for me, it's more in part to do what I think is right, and sort of not to allow people, or to not require people to sort of self-identify things that we're saying, you know, allow them to have their own privacy or their own choices on these issues. Do you think, it sounds like you're trying to find an alternative way forward, do you think that by providing a limited number of options, you meet those objectives?
In a way, yes, because I know there are some people who, I mean, I know like you don't want to separate the genders by colors, but there have been like some few people who have looked forward to wearing, in a way, that color on graduation, and then like obviously the law changes and you have to meet those requirements, but then in a way they got that, like, I mean, I don't really know how to say it, but they got that taken away from them. And like what we were trying to do is by meeting the regulations of the law and kind of what some students wanted, we kind of proposed to have the option to choose the color so that in a way it meets both of the requirements and kind of what the students want as well.
If we were to say, okay, people can choose, say, up to two colors, do you think most boys would then choose blue and most girls would then choose white, and you'd still be forced to back to some of those situations we were trying to avoid?
Yeah, I mean, that might happen because of peer pressure, but then that's maybe offering like a third color would be able to get more people away from maybe the girls being all white and the boys being all blue, and you could kind of have like a mix of, say if we did like blue, white, and maybe gold, like some boys would choose gold, some girls would choose gold, and then there'd be some girls maybe with navy, girls with white, boys with navy, boys with white. I mean, there's obviously gonna be some like pressures to choose a certain color, but like, I don't know, we were just trying to maybe get the option to choose it again, but it's obviously your decision.
I think the pressures is the
kind of the concern, the whole point.
Yeah, coercion can be very subtle.
Yeah.
What was the biggest concern about going from the traditional blue and white to a single color?
I think it's, I know a lot of people that I talked to were kind of bummed out that they got it taken away from them, and all of, basically from 7th to senior year, you pay this due to pay for your cap and gown, and then, yes, I understand, like, they had the girls being white and boys wearing blue, but then we also don't have, in a way, a say of what we can and can't do for something that we have been paying money for, fundraising for, and just giving, like, I mean, dues are kind of on the significant side. I think we paid $40 this year, and it would be nice in a way to have a say about what we could do with the money that we were giving the class.
I had no idea the dues were used for cap and gown. Is that true?
Yeah, the senior class, there are...
It's not just that.
I don't remember off the top of my head, but between the things that are divided up in terms of senior class trip and other activities, prom and things like that, they go through the years.
And it's yearbook.
Class trip.
In the senior year, the class trip.
That's good.
How all of those things end up being divided out, but that, yes, I think part of the dues create a fund so that they don't have to pay for their caps and gowns when they're seniors as well. So, but caps and gowns have always been assigned, again, by gender at the discretion of the school administration, except for some reports that I've heard in the past that some graduating classes perhaps had worn black entirely. And so I think there are very few cases where students had options at all in the past. They were simply assigned. Here, you've given them an option, and that may come down to me ultimately having to make a decision if the class isn't together anyways. So to point out one remark that came up in the first discussion, and this may have come from a student who ultimately had no preference, who indicated that, you know, obviously if there are going to be options and things that are going to be thrown out there in some sort of a democratic way. And now this will, I would move to make this a democratic process under one color that I would want the class to vote. and then work with the class advisors and the senior class officers to make a decision from there for this year. And that would effectively establish a new process going forward. But no matter what, under those circumstances, there are always going to be people who aren't going to get the color of their choice. So, you know, it's a, I wanted them to feel comfortable, these two felt comfortable being able to come forward and recount that and ask themselves on their own behalf for, at the very least, for their voices to be heard, but that we could take it from there.
And so that seems to be a hard issue, right? So up until the school committee decision, there wasn't really a choice, right? It was blue and white. Now we're saying you have a choice.
I'm not saying that we have a choice, but like most of our senior class kind of, at least, I mean, I wouldn't say most, but there is like a kind of a large number of students who in a way do want a decision with cap and gowns.
Sure.
Well, some schools just get away with cap and gowns entirely, but I think traditionally...
No caps and gowns?
Yeah, these are street clothes. But I think traditionally, not everybody...
Who want those caps? Are so miserable.
I think
okay, a new motion. Sorry.
Because they can't, yeah. But you know, traditionally, not everybody goes to college, so it's a chance for people to wear a cap and gown, and I think that's why it became a high school thing. And I think there's still some value to having the cap and gown for folks to wear. I think people are attached to that.
It helps with bobby pin sales, if nothing else.
If nothing else.
Yeah. And to go to Paul's comment, honestly, that was our goal, was to give you guys a choice, but have it be a unifying choice, and that you all have a say in what is ultimately decided and how you represent your class, whatever color is chosen through a democratic process, whatever it may be. And to not force it into something that, you know, feels forced and force people to choose. It's actually, rather than forcing people to choose, you're giving them this choice as a senior class together to come up with, this is as a class what we're gonna represent ourselves by way of the color of our cap and gown. So I mean, just backing up, that was the goal. And I think that some of it was maybe not as clearly communicated that evening, because we definitely did not want to dictate, you know, it must be this color.
Yeah.
And I think, in fact, we said we do not want to choose the color. That's up to you guys. But I think we also saw it as a unifying process, that by giving you guys that ability to choose what color that is, it is going to represent your class.
Mm-hmm. Well said. Well, I appreciate the dialogue. Jenny, do you have anything based on those conversations, Dad?
I'm in favor of either having one color or randomly assigning colors to students, because, like Roby said, I'm worried about peer pressure, not only from students but from the community. Mm-hmm. So that's been my concern through this whole process.
Yeah, it's fair. You mean we could give each student a different color?
Like we give them, like three options, and then like just go like have an
sandwiches at school at work, a lunch set.
Yeah, I see.
So,
how would it affect, or would it at all? I don't actually know. But the cap and gowns are actually rented by the school, so the kids don't own them in the end. So, would there be any effect on renting three colors versus renting only one, or whatever, like a cost factor or whatever?
No idea. I didn't even know dues were used to rent.
Yeah, so. I'm not sure.
But it sounds like the consensus of all of you is that we want to keep with the policy of one color, but give the senior class the choice of that color. And that we do that with the thought of not only unifying, but also
giving them a choice.
But making it comfortable for all.
Yes.
And yes?
Yeah, very much. And I appreciate Jenny's thoughtfulness on randomly assigning. I think I like the ethic. It might not feel like it to some right now, this idea of collectively deciding how you want to walk down the graduation aisle. I think that could be a unifying theme over the next few years.
Mm-hmm. If I may, so I'd like to comment. Typically at school committee meetings that I have been to many in other districts, student reps sit silently, take notes, and probably pray to the God of their understanding that it would end. That's what I think happens in most places. So I want to give you a tremendous amount of credit for your courage in engaging a governing body, for asking them to explain their thinking behind a decision, for asking them to potentially reconsider because some students felt differently. That takes a lot of courage. You did it very eloquently. You did it clearly. And I appreciate the school committee treating the students with the seriousness that they deserve. And I do believe that you always have the right to come and ask, why did you make that decision and help us understand it? And could you reconsider? So thank you for doing that so well.
It was done very well. Parties. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Sounds like it was a good dialogue.
Well, I mean, I think what's most impressive is that in dipping into the discussion with them after the vote, I was really impressed with how thoughtful students were. Certainly not all of them. You guys know that as well. But this is a graduating class that has a great deal of thought behind many of their actions. And as a result of that, they were really willing to engage in a really meaningful conversation about something that, you know, became a very serious issue to them. Mm-hmm. And it was, again, the idea of moving on from a tradition that they were looking forward to on the one side, and another side excited about the idea of, you know, making a change that was in the best interest of serving every student. And these two actually sit on opposite sides of the issue, and the dialogue, the opportunity to sit just with the two of them was fantastic, you know, at every phase of this process. So, but the students who brought the issue forward to the school committee and kept the issue going at school in other ways were phenomenal in terms of the way they dealt with it as a serious political issue within the school. And it's been very impressive in terms of a learning opportunity because kids took it that seriously. It's nice to be able to sit with students who are effectively adults, and not just these two, but so many in the senior class who have done a fantastic job with this discussion.
Well, I definitely appreciate that. And for me, it's definitely been a lesson about paying more attention to how we communicate our decisions. So if there's any feedback on this issue or anything I can do or we can do to better explain to folks our decision, we'd be happy to do that. And then in the future, as you all sit here to help us, remind us of those things, you know, tap us on the shoulder and say, hey, this is one where we need to pay attention to how we communicate it.
Okay. Thank you. And now you can go back to hoping that it's
open. I don't think they
Chris, would it be too much trouble for me to log into my Gmail account from your computer? Can I log into Gmail from there?
Yep. Okay.
Okay, I saved that to my desktop, this one.
No, so you want I just would like to show the school committee before we look at the FY17 budget, because there's two parts to that budget. One part of it is, what is the level services budget? Mm-hmm. The other part has some, in the budget documents that were included in your packet, has, here are some additional requests and the justifications for those requests. If you see that also, I think a lot of that would be great.
Are you jumping to budget now?
No, I'm doing that HES double data.
Okay.
I'm saying the reason I would like you to see it is because our needs-based request.
I see. Thank you.
Excuse me. Yes, our needs-based request. We asked for things. I'm going to have this. I just want to quickly show you some data that demonstrates, I think, that these investments are paying off or having their intended results.
Yeah, it's good. It's really cool. Look, I'm wearing cheetah print. I can't ask.
Could you remind us what DIBLES stands
yes.
for?
Yes. Basic early literacy skills.
Dynamic indicators.
Dynamic indicators.
Basically, I knew that our people do.
It's German.
I'll make this look better, and there's only three slides, four slides. So I'm just going to try to do this. All right. So what it is, don't try to read that, I'll say. Overall, dynamic indicators of basic early literacy skills. You were gracious enough to support our reallocation of two educational support professionals
from special education into general education in the early grades. Because last year I showed you data, actually we have one of our first grade teachers here, but last year you all saw data that showed when we created conditions in the first grade in which Ms. Cristoforo and the other first grade teacher could group students for specific literacy interventions. They saw some pretty tremendous gains. Actually, Ms. Cristoforo's data, which is similar to the data you'll see between benchmark one and benchmark two in grade two, she had students who were very far below benchmark, the goal where they should be. They all ended up at or above benchmark. What that means is that there's an 80 to 90% likelihood that they'll meet all of the literacy challenges and literacy standards in the next grade. So that's what they exited first grade with. And so we decided to expand that model, put it into grades one, two, and three. And what did we see? This is very helpful.
Roll the cart back.
There you go. Easy.
Yes.
I want to just give up is what I want to do right now.
Go to view present.
Not much better, but I can tell you. What do you want to pay attention to here? In kindergarten, developmentally, this is great news, but developmentally, you can expect children to be a little bit more all over the place. And as students age, we expect them, one, to have greater retention from summer to the start of fall, and we also expect their literacy to follow more standard patterns. So, but the good news is, in kindergarten, this B1 is a diagnostic test that students are given, or assessment that they're given in the fall. For kindergarten, that's things like first letter naming, recognizing sounds. The assessments change somewhat from grade to grade. And so what we see between the two benchmark assessments is that we still have a slight increase in students who are core support means they will meet, they are able to achieve in a general education setting. They don't need additional supports. It is highly likely that they'll be successful in kind of a general education delivery model. They don't need additional support. What this tells you is what the goal was, the green line, the composite score, the composite literacy score. The goal for students was 26 in the fall. They came in, their average score was a little bit higher. And now they're not quite at goal, but they certainly, they're gaining, and they're not in a critical place. And again, we expect things to happen in kindergarten. We expect students to be at very different developmental levels. Grade one is off the charts, and because Ms. Cristoforo is here, I'll say that 100% of her students are actually are at or above benchmark now. But you see, when the first graders came in, just about 21% of them were at benchmark when they entered first grade. And now about 77% of our first graders are at benchmark, just in our second benchmark assessment. The goal for first graders at benchmark two was a score of 130, and their mean score was 195. So they've had tremendous gains.
Benchmark two was December?
When it was just given in January,
January.
Correct?
We just finished last week.
Yep. And so do we have May or June? Are those numbers, is the green, the lower green line going to change for May or June? Are we going to change our goals?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Mm-hmm. And so that's not what I wanted to do, but there we go. And so now in grades two and three, so we've seen a slight increase of students in grade two. And what the good news is, so we've seen a slight increase here, I should say. And the good news is that our actual score is 252, and the goal for grade two was 190. So they're above goal at this point. We still have about 15% of our students, but that's decreased to 22% of the students needed intensive interventions at the start of the year. So we designed an instructional delivery model that grouped kids according to their needs, specifically around literacy and specifically around the skill needs that they demonstrated that we saw on this assessment. And as a result, we've seen a 7% decrease in students who need intensive support overall in their composite score. And in grade three, We've seen, we stayed about constant in terms of students who were requiring core support. But again, the goal was 285, and their mean score on their composite literacy assessment for grade 3 is 371. So we wanted to make sure, I'm showing this to you because one, it's one of our goals in our district improvement plan. In your second goal that indicates that we'll create learning conditions in which the needs of all students are met effectively. And specifically, we talk about organizing instruction in such a way that it's tiered or it meets the needs of all students. So I wanted to provide you with evidence that we definitely have our eyes on the ball. And before we ask you to entertain, so tonight the school committee, just so folks in the public know, tonight is not a vote on the budget, it is not the public meeting of the budget. Tonight's discussion is a preliminary discussion so the entire committee can give the finance committee some direction on refining the budget. But because, in addition to a level services budget, we've requested some resources, I wanted to demonstrate to you that before we ever request resources, we do an analysis of the intelligence of our existing resource allocation strategy. And I would argue that these data indicate that we're on the right track. Do you have any questions about the scores, about how to do a PowerPoint presentation? I offer classes in that. I'm really good at it, the public, or anything.
I still don't get the goals. Are you picking the benchmark 1, 2, and presumably there will be a 3? Are those goals set in August?
No, the goals are set by the assessment company. So the DIBELS assessment says this is where you want children to be. At this benchmark, you want your mean
based
score.
On our kids or based on the state or the nation?
They're a national test. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that B1 was 141 and it's nationally 141 for grade 2 in September?
Yes. They say in the fall you want this
composite
score.
So we know what June's number
seeing.
Is because
Correct.
They provided it to us. We aren't choosing.
Correct.
Right.
Okay.
So this green is the benchmark that's set for you really want, if you have a mean score of this, you're looking at your students being collectively in really good shape to achieve future, the next literacy milestones. And we're exceeding a few separate grades in grade 3 by a long shot.
Okay, thank you.
Sure.
All right.
I guess the rest of you got this. Any other questions?
Okay.
We can go to the budget. Dr. McKenzie, can I add something about that?
You most certainly may.
Can I just wanted to add that one thing that I think that is also really nice to hear, you know, as a teacher, is that many, many parents have complimented a lot of the teachers on the work and the progress that they've seen from their students this year. And that means, you know, obviously it means an awful lot to us as a teacher. But moreover, the parents are saying, my children are really enjoying going to these groups. In first grade, we're doing something a little bit different than second and third, a little bit extra magic, I would say. So we're actually crossing over by classroom. So Ms. LaValle is the teacher this year. So her and I have children pooled together by skill deficit. And we have children grouped that way. Whereas the other grades are doing it a little bit differently. But I think in hearing from so many parents, I think it's, you know, just something that I wanted to pass on that, you know, to hear from so many parents that they feel that their children's needs are being met really very individually, I think really says a lot. And I attended, I'm also on the PTO, I'm the teacher representative for the elementary school for the PTO. And attended a meeting there where this was being discussed. Mr. Udall had brought it up. And to hear, again, so many parents say, my child just loves it. They love mixing classrooms. They love being where they feel very safe and very comfortable and where their skills are at so that they can develop. That's sort of the premise for this model. But I think it's really great. And I personally really appreciate the fact that we've been able to bring up so many children's scores because of the support of the school committee who is funding these positions to be able to make this happen.
Thank you.
And I'd like to add something too. I just want to commend the teachers. From the time that we started last year, when we had serious discussion about this model and our visits up to the Shelburne Buckland school and their gracious they graciously helped us. From the work that we did during the summer and through the fall to where we are now, we are definitely seeing the benefits. And that's a tribute to the teachers and the work that they've done collaboratively, as well as the two paraprofessionals who have been designated as support, the unofficial title intervention support people. And you know, we're very excited about the results. When we got the results from last week's testing, we were really impressed. And so you saw just a snapshot of it. But again, it's making a big difference. And again, the literacy that we're targeted, it begins with that, and that's, you know, it'll expand beyond that. And the intent is to try to expand this up into grades 4, 5, and 6 going forward. And again, you know, as Paula said, we're able to do the crossing over in first grade this year. In other grade levels, we have for each classroom, with the exception of kindergarten, a designated intervention block, 30 minutes each day. With expanding it upwards, we won't have that luxury, and we will end up doing more crossing over by grade levels, which I think has been beneficial and is what other districts have done. Buckland Shelburne has done this, and it's a model that you know, we've been able to effectively use in first grade, and we will expand on it in the future. So I'm excited about it. So
thank you. All right, and so on to the budget. And even before we run through the slides, Chris, just I think it might be helpful if we go, if the school committee, so in the school committee packet, or maybe, no, we'll do the review first before you go through the numbers. So what are some of the big things that affect the budget and what's changed? The first good news, right, our school choice is really going in the right direction. So you had your top line, the number of students choosing in FY 14, you had 78. In FY 15, might I say July 1 of that year is when you hired me, it's all about me. You have 99, 97 now coming in, and your school choice out is definitely headed in the right direction as well. So between FY 15 to FY 16, you now have a choice out. What am I looking at in terms of difference? I don't know.
14.
Oh, I was looking percentage, but I was going to embarrass myself in front of Jenny and Bridget, so I'm not going to do that. So it's headed in the right direction. And what else has changed? We can go on to, there's only a couple. What are we looking at in terms of FTEs? Of course, if we do a level funded budget in FY17, then no FTE change. The FY17 needs actually is 1.5 increase rounded up to 60. Additional support at the elementary school and moving the tech integration specialist to full time. Total salaries at a level service, and Chris, you're going to, I can't read those from here again.
Level service, looks like it's about $5,210,000 and change. The needs base goes to $5,299,000 plus.
And last year, total salaries in FY16 were 4.96. So,
I'm sorry. What's the difference? 5 million.
5.2 versus 5.21 versus 5.299. Is that right?
I thought you said 5.1 to 5.29, and I'm like, wow! I want those positions.
Yeah.
Well, there's a jump from 16 at 496 to 5210, right?
That's correct. Right.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's not due to an increase in positions. That's the contractual increases. Mm. Yep. That.
Well, okay. But it is some positions. I think it's the classroom.
Wouldn't yes. It?
It's the addition
You're
of the new
correct.
Classroom.
The substantially separate classroom.
Mm-hmm. Isn't it?
It
would be, because that was not actually in the FY16 budget,
right.
Correct.
Mm-hmm. And then finally, out-of-district tuition. This includes both vocational, Smith Folk, and special education. And you can see that this is something that does increase, and sometimes it increases exponentially. And these are costs that over which we don't have any control. Because if a team determines that the least restrictive environment is a school other than ours, We are obligated, the town's obligated to pay that, and if a child elects to pursue vocational education, the town is obligated to pay for that.
This is based on what kind of percent increase did you assume for Smith Folk? Did you?
From a dollar?
16 to 17.
The percentage
increase. Very slight increase, actually. We haven't gotten the actual number yet, so. Mm-hmm.
But I thought the people, the numbers of people going out of the school reduced dramatically.
That's choice out. So those figures show up not in out of district tuition. These bars you're looking at would be for a student who requires a specialized placement at a private school, okay, or a student who's going for vocational education. The school choice would be a student who's going to Amherst instead of Hadley.
Okay, so that's not shown here. Mm-hmm.
And the financial impact is different. That's a $5,000 loss or gain on school choice. And these are full tuition. Smith is roughly $18,500 for starting, and then there's surcharges. And special education out-of-district placements can range anywhere from $46,000 to technically up to $250,000, but typically from $46,000 to just over $100,000 per student per year.
I think it's going to go down.
So this change could just be a change in a couple students.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All right. So, and finally, your special education reserves, or sometimes we say school choice, but we've done this so the town understands why we keep that money. And these go through your balances. So what your balance was at the start of FY16 down to our projected ending balance. Of course, now you're going to minus $15,000 from that projected ending balance.
So that's to help pay for the previous slide? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Correct. And so in your packet, you have a detailed budget, FY17 level services budget. You also have a summary page, the summary of budget changes from FY16 total budget to FY17 level services. So there's a reasonable question to ask, you know, how is it that a budget that is a level services budget still increases by just over 4%? Why doesn't level service stay the exact same? So a level services budget actually has about a $332,000 increase to it. The primary drivers for that are COLA, STEP, and lane changes in contracts. So, and roughly the increases when you put together COLA, STEP, and lane usually go between 4 and 5% overall. And people are moving downing years of experience and across lanes of education. And additionally, in the elementary school, we're advocating, and we believe this is level services, for increasing the science curriculum line by $15,000. Last year we invested in Hopkins Academy science curriculum, and this year we'd like to invest in the elementary. And the remaining, there was a slight increase in the school cost of the school physician contract. In the maintenance cost center overall, there were some COLA, STEP, and lane changes. We did increase general maintenance based on the historical spending, and the building and ground subcommittee will talk a little bit about their last meeting, and that we have seen an increase in cost in terms of general maintenance of facilities, but we had a significant decrease in utilities. So the overall increase in the cost center was still less than 1%. Because our utilities costs are projected to be quite low. As Chris told you at our last meeting, we locked in at a low rate. And in our special education cost center, in summary, at level services, the increase is still almost 8%, at 7.6. Again, there are teacher salaries in this cost center, paraprofessional salaries. But additionally, we have an increase of just over $25,000 in contracted services for the board-certified behavior analysts. Those services are needed for students with significant behavioral challenges who require intervention plans that are overseen by a certified and licensed professional. And we have budgeted just over $100,000 in increase of out-of-district tuition payments that we anticipate at this point in time. Not all of those are finalized.
Can I ask a question?
Of course.
Lane change, so is that somebody who gets
another degree?
Degree? Okay.
So the way the salary schedule is set up for the public, if you're not familiar with public sector bargaining contracts, years of experience are called steps, and a lane correlates with your educational attainment. So that's a bachelor's, a master's, sometimes in our case, master's plus 15, plus 30, plus 45, for teachers or Unit A.
Okay.
Or a doctorate.
Great.
And I'll say again, the point this evening, it's not a public hearing. I mean, it's a public meeting. It's not the hearing, the official hearing, because this was just a starting point. The town said, we are requesting level services budgets from departments. I know that there are departments who are doing exactly what we have done, which is this is level services and these are the things we think we need. And I believe that the next steps would be the finance subcommittee, which is Linda and Heather would come together, but I thought it was important that the entire school committee kind of give them some thoughts before we have a smaller meeting.
Well, the town will tell you that the increase in their revenue is what, 300,000 net? And that we are asking, even at level services, for more than that.
And the increase in their funding net is to be distributed amongst all departments.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That is our challenge.
A significant one.
Yes.
I'd also, and I want to make sure that I give, and I know the school committee, I do know that the school committee takes is very careful and is thorough with the packet. You also can see that we included not just the numbers on a needs request, these are additional positions and supports that the school thinks or the district thinks would be important, but there is an explanation of why and the data to back that up also.
And this calls for 520 from school choice?
Yes.
And what are we bringing in per year?
Well, let's see, 545 this year. I put 500 next year, just assuming 100 students. Mm-hmm. Again, you know, mm-hmm. plus or minus, but right around there.
Mm-hmm. Not the most stable financial picture.
No.
As are the school districts doing the same thing?
Yep. Remind me the timing. When do we need to have, when is the town hoping we have this done? I'm sorry, I wasn't at the last
the
meeting
town,
with the town.
So what we've given the town wanted budget figures in early January. We asked the town to use the projected budget that actually I believe was created with the school committee and Donna Moyer. So they already had projection figures. The projection figures that they had was an increase of just over 6%. Am I correct on that, Chris?
Yes.
So, and the reason we suggested that they go with that, they already had those figures, is for this reason. I said we need to go to the school committee. We have some things that are unsettled, including we don't know all of our out-of-district tuition payments at this point in time. Mm-hmm. So use that number. And then I explained our timeline, which was this meeting. Finance committee comes together. School committee comes together again. And there's a budget hearing, a public budget hearing in March at the March school committee meeting. And David Nixon has done a very good job of reminding all of the select board and FinCom that the budget timeline that you all adhere to, including having to have a public meeting that we advertise, we have to adhere to that. We don't just adhere to the town's timeline.
So you, what was the request? What was the figure that you gave the town for your total local funding requested? Is it 6799?
No, it was the projected figure that was put together previously.
Years ago.
It was about just over a 6% increase. These mm-hmm. were numbers that the town had of projected, and I told them to keep it. They already had it from the school department. I didn't give them any new figures.
Yeah, my question about that is that I believe that the finance committee and the board of selectmen, and I didn't watch the meeting, so
mm-hmm.
Were presented with the town budget last week, and so we didn't really give them a figure then.
No, we told them to use the figure that they had previously received from the school committee and the superintendent as a projected. It was a 6% increase. It was just. I'll look it up.
And I emailed the chair of the Board of Selectmen saying mm-hmm. we were meeting to discuss,
yes.
Have a first discussion at our January meeting.
Okay.
And that we were waiting for some out-of-district placement costs.
I can get it, Chris. Okay.
So they know we're working on it. Okay. And Pat, the 103 increase in out-of-district tuition payments, is that as high as you think it will be, or have we put in the most conservative number or the most optimistic number?
Well, I think it's realistic. but there are always surprises that can't be predicted. So,
okay.
It's realistic.
Okay.
Okay, any other thoughts from people preliminarily? And how is it that Heather and I got on this finance committee? Who assigned that?
I don't know, but it's in some minutes. I found it in some minutes, yeah, and so.
I know. All right, so we are we, oh no, we have a personnel report. I thought, yeah. Wow.
Yes, we do. So our personnel report, one of the most important things that I say with a heavy heart, although I'm happy for an employee when they make a decision that they believe is the best decision for them, is that our Assistant Superintendent of Student Services, Ms. Pat Bell, will be retiring. And we believe the retirement will be effective the last day of July. Right? July 31 is what we're thinking. Is that, but that is still to be determined, as your personnel report reads. But that's to give you a general sense. So, Pat, thank you. Thank you. It's been, we still have plenty of time, but I just want to publicly say that when I announce this, I deeply appreciate all that you've done to help me as a superintendent and as a person. Thanks.
It feels thank like you just got here to me.
Yeah.
It does, but in some ways. In others, it seems like a long time, but.
I hope you enjoy your retirement.
For me, because I worked with her for 5 years before. So
that's
I,
right. Right.
I feel like it's been too long.
And something I would like to mention to the school committee for consideration, Pat and I have been talking quite a bit about the aspects of her job that are really enjoyable and some of the demands of the position that are just a little untenable would be an understatement, mm-hmm. probably. And so we've talked about, is this perhaps an opportunity for the school committee to look at how we organize the service delivery administrative function as it pertains to special education? Mm-hmm. One thing that I did was I reached out to Bill Deal. He's the executive director of the Collaborative for Educational Services, where we're a member. And I said, would the collaborative have the expertise and the willingness to perhaps help the school committee think through what are various options in service delivery models? So this is about, example, the collaborative may be taking on some of the special education administrative leadership functions, maybe sharing that function with another district and investing in more of a coordinator function to deal with paperwork and having an educational team leader. Do we do a model that's similar to Hatfield's? What I would be asking the collaborative to do, if the school committee had any interest at all, an assistant superintendent is entirely, that's the school committee's. If you had any interest, the collaborative would certainly be willing to have conversations with, I imagine what it would look like is getting input from me, from Pat, from the administration, from teachers, from the school committee about, and parents about what's going well, and I know CPAC, the Special Education Parent Advisory Council, will be here next month doing a presentation with Pat and going through some survey data that they will have gathered about perceived strengths, possible opportunities to improve. So if the school committee has any interest, I'm happy to reach out to the collaborative and say, could you put together a proposal of how you might assist with thinking through this? Anytime there's a change in a major and important administrative function, it's always an opportunity for an organization to say, is this the best service delivery system, or should we think of organizing services differently?
So that's a basically consulting that we would pay to help us with?
Right. That would be to say, here are all the options. What I think would be helpful is to say, based on your capacity, based on your budget, here's a variety of options that you have. Here are the pros and cons of each option. And then the school committee could say, we want to keep it exactly as it is. We'd like to try this option over here.
Well, for me, before we say yes to that, I'd like to know how much they would charge us.
Just for this. Mm-hmm.
And also, Pat, not to put more on your plate before you leave us, but it would be nice to know, to have your perspective presented to us about what has been great, what has been hard, and what you would recommend to us going forward, if you would be willing.
Oh, I would welcome that.
I think that would be great.
I've already started having conversations with Annie about, well, in a process of looking at what might want to look different so that things felt more manageable. And I'd be happy to share that kind of info.
I think that would be great. I don't know how quickly you can do that, but it would, I think, would also help to inform the information we get from the collaborative on the cost and the service that they would provide.
And we'll have the survey results from the CPAC February meeting.
Yep.
Yes.
Yeah, we've already discussed what kind of information we can guess what might be interested from another outside perspective, but there's information I've already gathered from staff and data on just what this, the landscape looks like month by month during the year for the special ed functions. So I think we can get some really useful info to get on that.
That would be awesome.
And I think Pat and I had talked about in February, Pat was already prepared to provide, before she had even made a final determination, I want to say, about retirement, we had talked about presenting to the school committee, here is the existing service delivery model.
Yep.
And also then the Special Education Parents Advisory Council wanted to come and talk with the school committee. So that may be a perfect time.
Mm-hmm.
That would dovetail right into that. Okay.
All right.
And I just wanted to answer your question, Roby. I found the email. What the town had was a figure of $6,867,453 was what they had in for projected FY17 that they had received a couple of years ago.
And you had 699.
All right. An hour and a half later, have we made it through our presentations?
Yeah, I think it's yes.
We are in the public comment period.
Public has nothing to say.
Okay. We are done with our public comment period. District strategy progress report.
I think most of it you have seen.
Like we've
it's
kind
in there.
Done it.
Yes.
Yep.
Yeah. So the biggest thing is providing you with data around the impact of tiered instruction around goal 2.
Yep. All right. Hey, Chris.
Hey.
You're up.
Okay. We have a few items. The first would be the expense report that you all have in your packages. Sorry to disappoint you, but there's really nothing exciting.
It's probably a good thing.
Yeah, that makes us happy.
Yeah,
Chris.
Lack of excitement is always a good thing
yep.
with the budget. Most of these accounts are right on track with where we'd expected. There are a few items in there that are over budget. Those will be addressed with transfers. A couple of them look like they're negative, but in reality they won't finish that way. I'm looking at something, for example, the telephone account. There's no way we spend more than what we budgeted for it, but we have the full amount and then some encumbered. We've restructured a lot of our accounts, so we're not going to spend that much. So it does show that we're about $186 in the hole. In reality, we're probably a couple thousand dollars to the good. So we have those kind of things where we'll adjust the encumbrances to reflect actual expenses that we've seen so far this year. So really, again, nothing that causes me to sweat at night or anything, so that's good.
That's excellent.
Is that the same with the fuel, oil, and gas?
Yeah, the fuel oil actually is another one of those situations where, in the beginning, Mary encumbered based on what we had spent last year, and we got a lower price than last year. We basically bought, I think it was 42,000 gallons of fuel last year. We will use it all, but no more than that. We also budgeted for 1,000 gallons at the central office. We won't, at $3 a gallon. Obviously, we're not going to spend that either. So that's another one of those items that shows it's in the negative a little bit, but won't finish that way. Next, we have the revolving accounts report through November 30th. That's the latest figures I have. Again, you can see athletic is now starting to move up as we get to events that have attendance costs with them. Get the deposit slips when I come in every other day, basically. They're coming in now, so that's certainly nice to see that moving up. Lunch, again, in the negative, but it came back a little bit from October to November. You can see it was $3,000 in the hole, and now it's $110, so.
Why? People just paid up?
It could have been a combination of people paid up or a timing issue as far as getting reimbursement from the state.
Okay.
Because you can see it went from positive $2,800 to negative $3,000 in a month. It's one of those things, whenever the money comes in, and not only when the money comes in, but when it's posted to the account.
I was going to say, that's a lot of unpaid salad bar.
I know. Chris kind of stood in the line.
We did have, if I'm not mistaken, we had two fajita days in a two-week period of time, and that's a big deal.
Fajita days makes $2,000 apparently. Do them every day.
Yep, they'll be going Mexican from now on. any questions on that at all? Okay, then we have the grant report. Again, not a lot of excitement there. A couple of items to point out. You can see the Title II-A Teacher Quality Grant still has not been used. That will be used. A lot of that money, actually all of that money, will come into play when we've used all of the Title I money out. It's a salary issue. We're just paying it all out of one grant first, then we'll move over to the other. So. It's not like we've forgotten about it or anything like that. Circuit breaker, we can carry over money if we are able to. That will certainly be nice. We carried over a little over $50,000 this year. That's a nice little cushion. And we actually brought in this year significantly more than we expected. It is reflected in this amount, but when we did the budget last year, we expected about $88,000. We ended up taking in $121,000. So. That certainly is a nice little bonus for us. You know, it's nice to cover any unexpected tuitions that we might come up with during the year. Other than that, again, kind of a dull report. That's all I have tonight.
Status of generators. I don't know why I had that on there.
Yeah,
just because the excitement
and school buses. I can fill you in on that as well. We did place the order for the mid bus, I think it's called, which is the 12-passenger bus, and that will be in, they're thinking, 6 to 8 weeks. So we placed the order a couple of weeks ago for that. We also were approved to buy the full-size bus, so Tricia is working on getting specs for that, and then we'll go out to bid for that item. And the generator project, we awarded the contract. We have a signed contract. They have ordered the generator. Now it's just in one of those lead times where there could be up to an 8-week delay in receiving the generator, which is probably going to work out okay because really there's not a heck of a lot that they're going to do in the middle of winter anyway. So it'll be a springtime project, but things are moving forward. They requested yesterday, actually, I got an email from them asking for our tax certificate, so I sent that to them today. And that's basically where we stand. So it's moving forward. At least we know. I won't say no.
Yeah.
At least we expect.
Just tell us when they're installed.
When we start school in September, everything will be completely done with that. So.
And you need the school committee to vote on the creation of a student activity fund for the service trip to Nicaragua.
That's correct. Yes. Whenever we open a new student activity account, we need school committee approval for that. And they just wanted to open an account to keep those funds separate, so.
Anybody?
Motion to approve establishing a student fund account for the trip to Nicaragua.
Seconded.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay, done.
Can I ask about the bus?
Yeah, the chassis.
You can.
The chassis.
Yeah.
So will this bid that we put out on the new bus talk about like an all-new bus, not just a...
Yeah, basically everybody else assumed all new bus.
Okay.
We will specify in this bid, perhaps.
We will ridiculously specify that.
Yeah. All new.
He stopped communication with us, you know, in terms of subtle threats about, gee, I'd hate to have to turn over your bid and things like that. So I think he must have really just gotten the hint that, you know, gee, everybody else seemed to have gotten our message but you. That's certainly a good thing. And yeah, the bus we'll get will be a completely 2016 bus. And we will spell that out in great detail, probably many times in the bid specs for the next full-size bus that we get.
Cool.
But it did add a little interest into the normally dull bid process.
Did you get any permission to hire the collaborative to do that?
No, we asked her. No, because we asked her to get a price. No.
I was just checking to see if you were even interested in the idea.
Oh, okay.
If that's all I was trying to see is, would you like me to, just even...
Thank you for clarifying.
While we're talking about school buses, I don't know who to look at for this. An email...
Preferably not me.
An email came that one of the bridges in Hadley's been posted. Does this change our school bus routes?
And I can speak a little bit to that. Tricia came in and spoke to me about it last week and said that she wasn't sure at this point that it might require red and orange bus to do some rerouting, but she was waiting for additional information from town hall on that. So that's the update on that.
And if it does, we will communicate via the one call? Okay.
Yes.
We will. I have one final operational item, library surplus.
Yes, that was on.
Library surplus, so I don't copy this for all of you, but I do require school committee approval. You've been through this process now.
Yes.
Our media specialist with the teachers needs the staff, and the school committee needs to declare a surplus and to do recyclables. So I would need a vote, if you're willing, if you would like to vote on declaring the library materials as surplus is recommended by the media specialist on her list dated November 23rd, 2015.
So do we recycle them like pulping them, or do we recycle them by giving them to...
Giving them. There's a book. Yeah. Judy, actually, our media specialist, Ms. Bohall, drives to these various bins that actually take the books.
Right. Is this the same list that we saw in December?
No, I believe I have a new list for you. Honestly, I believe it's a new library surplus list. You most certainly can, because it's for January, I see.
So that's in it. I just added to the full list. She's just added to the full
list. Correct.
Okay. So how are these books chosen?
So she chooses them. Sometimes it's one of the criteria is how frequently the book is checked out. Another criteria is depending on the subject matter, she brings together teachers. So they recently weeded the science stacks. She brings together the science teachers. They make determinations about the relevance of the material, how likely it is that students would need the material, how relevant it is. So she asks the content area specialist to come in. She looks at how frequently the books are checked out. And she also uses other professional criteria. I was at a conference with her, but they don't just look at how frequently something's looked at. They look at things such as bias. How is your entire collection representative of a diverse student body? Not necessarily just your student body, but do you have reading materials available for that and that represent a multicultural, diverse kind of student body?
Good.
Okay, everyone comfortable?
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Can I get a motion to dispose, recycle, whatever?
I make a motion to dispose of extraneous books at Hudson's Academy.
Thank you.
Second it.
Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. I believe we're on to school committee reports. The finance subcommittee will be meeting. It's my report. Do you have anything else, finance subcommittee member?
Put it on my calendar. Right? She just found out she was on it about 10 minutes ago.
I'm looking forward to it.
Heather, Unit D, parent survey.
Okay, Unit D, we saw at the last meeting, we talked about next steps in terms of negotiating the compensation. And unfortunately, we haven't been able to meet since that meeting, but we did receive the proposal from Unit D, and we meet this week on Wednesday to go through that. So that's where we are. Survey, it think February we had slated bringing the questions back. We may have said January, but that didn't happen. So February.
I think we said February.
Okay, good. You weren't here then.
I know. So. I know.
So we'll bring those February, go through and make sure that I think we wanted to kind of cull out some of these questions. It was a little long last time, like really wicked long. So we'll get some of that stuff off there. And Humaira had made some suggestions at the last meeting as well on that. And speaking of surveys, I'll just put a plug in for the CPAC survey that is going out Wednesday. I believe we got a one call from Mike Duffy about that this week. So please respond to that.
So, yes, so we will, you can anticipate getting a survey, a link to a survey on Wednesday, all families, and we strongly encourage families to fill it out. I sat with a member of the Special Ed Parent Advisory Council. It's a short survey, easy to fill out, so please do.
It's far shorter than our parent survey.
Yes.
So that's my goal. Trent. That's all I have.
Thank you. Which of you guys is doing building and grounds?
I don't know, which of us can remember what happened at the last meeting.
So I think the big news is our next meeting is February 3rd at 4 p.m. Annie, is that going to be in your office?
Yes.
And we'll have a representative from Brookshire Design Group to talk about the design they've done for the athletic fields here at Hopkins. And the questions we're going to be asking is phasing out all that work. I think now it's estimated at over $1 million, and see if we can break it into more manageable bite-sized pieces. And I know we've worked with some, there's some members of the public that have been interested and engaged, and so we've made sure that they know about this meeting as well.
We also, we're gonna have an expense coming up at Hopkins Academy around the heating system. It needs to be computerized. The original vendor went bankrupt, and so our new vendor. The heating system at Hopkins requires constant repair.
Well, I mean, the good thing is that, and we'll be engaging in this process with Jeff next year, and obviously bringing it to the subcommittee and working with Jeff on this, but, you know, we'll need to have, be organizing our next 3 to 5 years in terms of maintenance of the building anyways to be able to present to an outside organization.
So it makes sense to kind of be doing that work now and planning.
And it's about a $5,000 expense for a new vendor to get us online so they can look at our heating system and diagnose problems off-site instead of having to come here and look for them.
And I should say one
so
thing
we're
that
doing
we...
that. We're spending that money now this year. Is that what your guys are telling us?
That's what we're looking to do currently. This is right. To have the HVAC people who came in with the problems that we had. We have an immediate fix right now, but we would probably be looking to, actually in FY17, I believe, put that system online. So
that's correct, yes.
Yeah, so we've made it at what we believe is the best fix we can until the system is online with the new vendor. Mm-hmm. They kind of have to wait and see. Fortunately, it's been rather warm, and it would be an actual FY17 expense is where we've put in spending that money.
Excuse me, you could take care of it over the summer.
Mm-hmm. Another thing we're talking about and that we put on the capital timeline is the air conditioners for the HES classrooms. So I know there's a guesstimate here of just $400,000. I think that was based more on what's happened here at Hopkins years ago. Mm-hmm. So obviously it's just a rough estimate, but we know it's becoming an increasing problem. The rooms are so hot that students can't learn. So. Mm-hmm.
And Chris, is that for heat pumps or is that for an old-fashioned air conditioner kind of system?
It'd be similar to what we have here with the outside units for each classroom.
Okay.
I don't think
they're just much cheaper to run. Heat pumps are much cheaper to run.
Yeah, they're much more efficient.
Yeah,
we'd have to look into that. I have to be honest. Building AC units just not my specialty. So.
It's bus
buses. Everything about
that.
I can't recall if the school committee approved the last capital plan before it was sent over to town hall. Did you all approve it as a body? I'm sorry, I know we did.
I think we did.
So then there is a revision that the building and grounds, what Paul just said, there is a revision. The difference in this, what's in your packet, has the air conditioners.
Right, I think it did previously.
And the previous one did not. That was the recommendation that the subcommittee made. So it would require, if the entire committee is in agreement, that we would update our capital plan to reflect that.
And would that, I think we should, and then what's the next step on that, Annie, is to start, get it on the budget and...
Well, one thing is that we make sure that Town Hall has an up-to-date capital plan and that it's part of their entire townwide capital planning as well.
Right. The capital planning committee on the town side will start to convene soon. And frankly, I don't know which of us is on that committee. I've been on it for years.
I think it's you and Heather.
Probably.
I think it's me.
Yeah. Wouldn't it make more sense to have one of us? Since
that would make a lot of sense.
I'm being facetious.
Well, you're only on like three committees.
I don't need to be in another committee.
I'll find out who we... Okay. Well, it's in our minutes somewhere.
Yes.
It wouldn't be part of our budget. It would be a capital item that would probably have to be an article on town meeting,
right.
I'm guessing.
Right.
Because
right.
It's substantial.
So big.
But as far as adjusting for the AC price on the adding that change, that makes sense.
So once we get that, do we wait to... Or can we start now soliciting more clear estimates?
So I think one thing we want to be careful, I just want to make sure we don't lose sight of the fact that I'll have to record an actual vote. I just don't want to forget that. Is we always want to be careful. We can go out and get more specific costs, but the specificity of those, it costs money to get specificity. So we can certainly ask HVAC people to investigate heat pumps, to give us, we can get slightly more specific. But when you start inviting people out, they're kind of anticipating that that bid specs will follow, or we're producing bid specs and we're actually moving forward on a project.
That's why some of these are such rough estimates, because it's hard to ask a vendor to come in and spend several hours putting together a spec document only to find out that the project is 4 years out. You know what I mean? They tend to get a little annoyed with that, so we've tried to wait until we were closer to the actual project, and it's one of those catch-22s. You need to know a price before you can get funding, but it's also better to have funding before you get a price. So we're trying to split the middle with that, basically.
So motion to accept the new capital plan.
Motion to accept the new capital plan.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Can you send that over to the town for
us? Yes,
I will. Thank you. Roby, are you guys done? Okay, Roby, collaborative?
I have not met since my last report.
And the school committee charter school position?
It was just, we said last month that we were going to, the school committee wanted to wait until others were here. You don't have to take any position. I had said to you that I didn't feel comfortable signing on as an individual, that it would be something I would sign on as on behalf of the school committee if it was the school committee's position. And of course, it doesn't require that you do anything. I just wanted to present it as an option.
I'm sorry, is this weighing in on what Governor Baker is, that Governor Baker's proposing to increase charters?
A bit. So just quickly a little bit of history. In the packet last month, you had a couple of letters. One was originally signed by several superintendents representing their districts and asking that the local legislatures, just overall asking people to rethink current charter school expansion policy. Then in the Gazette, there was a response from the president of charter schools and a parent of a child in a charter school, and feeling that the letter, I think, was a bit of an attack on the importance of charter schools. I will say that the Collaborative for Educational Services has been very clear. That's not their position. What they're asking is for the legislature to think carefully about the policy and the disproportionate fiscal impact of the charter school funding model on small and rural districts. There is a disproportionate impact on Franklin, Hampshire, and some of Hampton County, and definitely Berkshire County, on how the current model is structured, and it doesn't have the same impact out in the Boston area.
Yeah.
Part of that has to do with the fact that charter is just one choice strategy, and out east, far fewer districts participate in school choice. And to borrow a line from one of my colleagues, Western Mass is school choice on steroids. So part of the argument is that we do provide choice. We're not arguing with choice as an option. We do that through school choice.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And it's fiscally more viable for us. And then I have said that one thing, I said it at the last meeting, I would like the legislature, I have no criticism of charter schools. I'm grateful for the ones we have in our community, the positive relationship we have with them and what they do for children. I am concerned that the state continues to refer to charter schools when in fact they are charter districts. They have the same administrative structures as a school district. the same associated more or less administrative costs as a result. And while they're talking about lifting a cap and expanding charter districts, there's also some encouragement for small school districts to reconsider their fiscal viability over the long term and consider regionalization. And that seems like an incoherent and illogical policy strategy.
And Senator Rosenberg's hearing on this is when?
Well, I think the one in Hampshire and Franklin County already happened. The one in Hampshire County.
Did you say February 5th? 5th
at 5. It's a Friday at 5 at the Bang Center.
It's a Friday night hearing?
I believe so, yeah. At 5 o'clock. He's really interested.
Senator, come on. Are we ready to take a position on this, or can I might try to go to the hearing.
Yeah, I mean, it is to have people who want to opine.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Probably be good if you can attend the hearing before we take an action on this.
All right, I'll try to go.
You can share information with us.
Yes, I will.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. Okay.
And appoint an alternate.
Heather can go.
Oh, that's right. Here you are.
Yeah.
Do we want to be safe just in the event that someone gets sick or something? Does it hurt to?
I have no plans to get sick.
Okay. All right.
I've already had my good.
Yeah. No. All right. Good. We don't need to do that. Great. Thank you.
All right. We just made it through the meeting, people.
Yay.
And we were begging for it to end, really.
Can we talk about our next date, though?
It's in February, according to this agenda.
Last year, 2015.
Oh,
as a matter of fact, according to this agenda, it's any day you want.
It's just any day we want in February. That's what it says.
Yeah, I'm just asking only because if we meet the 22nd, I'm definitely out. As I am on the 29th, so I wasn't sure if folks are open to. I'm fine if you want to meet without me, that's fine. I'm not going to be able to call him. So I'd have to have somebody else talk through the survey materials that I'm sure I will have ready for you.
What's the vacation week? Is that the 18th?
The week of the 15th.
So the
23rd? So you can't do the 29th? I'm sorry, Heather, you said you couldn't.
I'm out the 22nd through the 4th.
Okay.
Oh.
Wow. Okay, and well, let's leave it the 22nd for now, since Humira's not here, and I'll poll the group on different dates, because if we go the week before, we're now intruding upon vacation week.
Yeah.
So.
It's 5:30 or 5?
5:30.
Unless we need executive session.
Okay.
So, I'll poll the group. Okay. Right now, we'll keep it the 22nd. Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay. Please, can I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Thank you so much. Do we need a second and all in favor?
I'll second it.
Okay.
All in favor.
All in favor.
Aye.
Thank you.